patrol for a while, and I don't know what the exact current procedure is right now, but when I was doing these type of cases, you know, at least half the time, the woman wouldn't show up.
So what happens then?
At that time, the case would get dropped. At that time, I don't know what they're doing now. They have domestic violence advocates and all kinds of stuff.
Okay, but in the meantime, has that guy been in jail?
Well, he's in, you know, he's booked into jail, and, you know, then the jail does their procedure, and they you know, appear before a judge and get out or
how
whatever.
How fast?
It depends on what's going on in the system.
But that's, I mean, that is a fast process within 12, 24 hours, right?
Most likely, yeah.
Okay, so then he posts bail and all that.
Well, if need be, gets out.
Oh, that they're going to be arrested, period. Wouldn't that act as a deterrent?
Well, you'd think so, but it's been like that for at least 5, 6, 7 years.
Uh-huh.
And I don't know if it's been a deterrent in this state. You keep hearing about the, you know, DV cases going up and everything like that.
Well, I'll be. Well,
but,
learning.
I mean, what's the degree of hurt? I mean, you know, how do you determine within the definition of assault fourth degree, mm-hmm. you know, that it's a misdemeanor assault, how, you know, what's hurt? A batter... You know, I believe in the technical definition of battery, it's just, you know, unlawful touching.
Great points, Chris. Thanks for your call.
Okay.
I'm delighted that you called. We get a little firsthand info. To Sid, we go in Tacoma on King 1090.
Yeah, Rick, I kind of have to call you on the carpet for something you said yesterday, which I thought was really irresponsible.
All right, Chris. Sid.
You said that a woman could do anything and that the man cannot do anything in retaliation.
I did say that. You're right.
Okay, my take on all of this is, and something that is not getting focused on, is there's a cause and effect relationship to everything on the face of this planet. And a lot of times, and I've seen it happen, I'm not married, I'm gay myself, so I'm outside this issue completely, but I've seen it happen where men get emotionally abused by women to the point where they are backed into a corner and literally have no place to go.
Yeah, but I understand. I mean, believe me, most men have been in that situation at one time or another, but you're still not allowed to hit the woman.
Well, yeah.
Because you're too big and strong. You can hurt her.
To hit anybody, but I think we need to elevate domestic violence to the point where emotional abuse, because that's what it is. It's emotional abuse. When you abuse your husband, when you tell your husband's children that he is a bastard or that, you know, that
we agree. We agree that's emotional abuse. What's the point?
That should also be a jail offense.
Well, maybe it should be, but that would really clog the courts and would be impossible to prove because it would be a he said, she said in denial situation. When you have physical abuse, if you have any bruises, at least you have something to go on.
You just had that policeman say that there doesn't have to be any physical evidence. All the woman has to do is say this happened.
Yeah, I know. But I'm resisting your argument on the grounds that it trivializes the real tough cases.
No.
Wait a minute, and I'm resisting it for another reason, too. Even if you are emotionally abused, as many men and women have been, it does not make it okay to hit the person that's doing it.
Yeah, but you...
Unless it's a man. I mean, I think it's perfectly okay for a man to hit another man, but it is not okay for a man to hit a woman.
No, it isn't okay for a man to hit another man.
Well, of course it is, but that's a whole nother show.
No, it isn't. And
what do you... I hope you're not some kind of a peace, Nick.
What I'm getting at, Rick, is that there is a cause and effect. Now, somebody may not start out committing domestic violence, but as things escalate, they get to the point where violence happens.
Are you dangerously close to setting a scenario where it's okay to hit a woman?
No.
Are you saying that
it's not okay?
Well, then what's the point of this?
What I'm saying is that when you have a situation where you back one...
into a corner.
One of the people into a corner where they have nowhere that they can go.
Yes.
They have no options.
Yes. So, conclusion, please. Give me a conclusion.
So that's what happened.
So they're backed into a corner, so they smack the woman.
Well,
your conclusion, please. Are you going to give me a conclusion, Sid, or am I going to go crazy?
It isn't always.
Do you have a conclusion?
The woman. It's the woman that smacks the man sometimes. I saw that happen to my...
Chris, we're going around in circles. I needed a conclusion. It's logic 101. I had to have a stinking conclusion. Line 3, we go to Charlene in a car phone. You're on King 1090.
Hi, Rick.
Yes, Charlene.
You mentioned something about someone in L.A. who had written about domestic violence, that you could control a man's anger by keeping them close to you.
Yeah.
In that sense, I'm not saying that this is a rational thing, but I think I kind of understand it.
Let me repeat it so that people know what we're talking about. How they're seeing their lives played out on TV, the intimidation, how fearful they are, how they keep the guy close to control, how they keep the guy close to control his anger and abuse. I don't get that.
Okay.
Wait a minute, are you going to explain it?
I think I can.
Well then, Charlene, please let me put you in the cooler because I want to hear, I want you to have plenty of chance to clear up this mystery, and we will give you that opportunity when you come out of the cooler in a little bit. 1227 at King 1090.
My three-year-old, Claire, loves her new plastic scissors. So this week, when I brought in the mail, she was happy to see that Safeway's new coupon book arrived. For me, it's full of great coupons and great values. For Claire, it's full of pictures and coupons that are just waiting to be scissored. Peanut butter, cereals, cat litter, you name it, she'll clip it. I like the Safeway coupon books. They keep Claire busy. They save me money. And the proud look on Claire's face when she gives the cashier her coupons is worth almost as much as the money I save.
Take advantage of your new Safeway coupon book that just came in the mail. Save on Kraft macaroni and cheese dinners, top ramen noodles, Z paper towels, copper tone sun care products, and more. Value's good until August 2nd. Remember, nobody does it better than Safeway.
When was the last time you treated yourself to a professional therapeutic massage while listening to some of the world's best music? And I know it's not my music, but... but it's good. It's mighty, mighty good. And it's what you will experience when you visit Vicki Bliss, a licensed massage therapist at Sound Touch. She combines music and massage to give you an incredibly relaxing experience. It's wonderful. I've had this experience. It is terrific. Vicki's massages are results-oriented and very relaxing. She focuses on the areas of your body that hold the most stress and tension and pain and anguish and sadness. Using a combination of therapeutic massage techniques and music, she's able to facilitate the release of your pain and tension and engage your body's own mechanisms for healing. You'll leave the session feeling completely relaxed and with a new understanding of how your body physiology responds to stress. So take care of yourself, whether you need specific injury treatment, deep tissue massage, or purposeful relaxation therapy. Call Sound Touch for an appointment today. Conveniently located in Seattle near Tower Records, call 286-9054. That's Sound Touch at 286-9054. Also on Vashon Island, the phone number is 286-9054, Sound Touch.
King News Talk 1090, midday news update.
Good afternoon. It's 12:30 at King News Talk 1090. I'm Jane Shannon in the King 1090 News Center. A Los Angeles judge has tentatively agreed to question grand jurors in the O.J. Simpson murder case. Simpson's attorney, Robert Shapiro, wants to know if any of the grand jurors have been influenced by the deluge of publicity. He wants action taken if they've been swayed. Court will reconvene at 1:30 this afternoon. The hearing also featured a testy back-and-forth exchange between Shapiro and prosecutor Marcia Clark over media manipulation in the case. At one point, the judge asked them to stop. The prosecutor also disclosed a piece of evidence in the case. A blue knit cap was found at the feet of one of the murder victims. A health reform compromise has been hammered out. The group, led by Republican John Chafee of Rhode Island, has been working long hours behind closed doors.
We got a deal.
With everybody?
All aboard.
A bipartisan group of moderate senators has come up with a plan to insure 95% of Americans by the year 2002, and employers would not be forced to pay. The next step is debate by the full Senate Finance Committee. The superintendent of Seattle schools has come up with a new plan to turn the city's public school system into what he calls a premier district. King 1090's Alan Ray has the story.
At the school board's annual retreat, Superintendent Bill Kendrick has proposed adding 10 days to the school year to 190 days, but cutting class size to 20 students per teacher. He proposes the district expand education in the arts and music and start offering foreign language classes in the elementary grades. Kendrick concedes the cost could be as high as $40 million. Especially with his proposal for increased teacher compensation. But he says one way to get the money is to make the district so attractive that people elsewhere will want to send their kids to Seattle schools. Alan Ray, King News Talk, 1090.
Fire has destroyed a storage building for a gravel company in Redmond. The fire at Lakeside Industries was visible from Highway 520. It was reported about 10:45 this morning and burned well into the noon hour. Firefighters say there are no injuries. The cause is still under investigation. King County Police questioned two boys at the scene. It's 12:32 at King News Talk 1090. We'll check traffic and weather together next.
I want to tell you about what is probably the most important
against women.
The quotes that I did not understand were the following. This first one, they're seeing their lives played out on TV, the intimidation, how fearful they are, how they keep the guy close to control his anger and abuse, how they almost accommodate him in some ways. The parts of that I do not understand are how they keep the guy close to control his anger and abuse, and how they almost accommodate him in some ways. I understand neither of those comments by the executive director. Also, I don't understand this further on down, not by the executive director, but by someone else who says, a lot of times people don't honestly recognize what this behavior is. It's learned behavior. I'm not sure what the ramifications are of either one of those. So to help us solve the mystery is Leah Aldrich, the communications director for the Los Angeles Commission on Assaults Against Women. Leah, welcome to the show. Thank you.
Thank you.
You heard what I said there. Can you shed some light? I know you can't speak for the executive director, or maybe you can. Do you know what she was getting at there?
What she's getting at, and, you know, and Patty will, of course, let me know if I'm not paraphrasing her.
Okay.
But basically what happens is that women who are in abusive relationships, okay, they know their partners very well. They are the authority on what their partner will and will not do, what they're capable of and what they're not capable of. So in dealing with this cycle of violence, which is usually a three-stage cycle of battering, where the tension stage is the first stage, where she feels like she's walking on eggshells, the accommodating behavior becomes, kids come home, go immediately to the room. Don't do anything to upset your father. It becomes overcompensated behavior,
mm-hmm.
where they have to make sure that everything is always perfect in an attempt to stem the onset of the second stage of the violence,
sure.
the stage of the cycle, which is the actual abusive or violent stage of the cycle of violence.
Uh-huh.
They have to keep him very close. They have to keep a very close eye on him. They're watching for the little signs that may tick them off. It becomes very tense.
Oh.
So that's what they mean by they keep them very close. And the behavior becomes very accommodating. Anything to try and keep him from going into the next stage.
I understand perfectly. I'm sure the audience does, too, exactly what you're saying. Now, I must tell you, Leah, that the things that you have described, the tension, the overcompensation, and the need to do the other things you said about keeping close and
right.
accommodation in order to prevent the third stage, which I guess is the battering.
Eventually, the overcompensation of behavior will never be enough, okay? Because
uh-huh.
there will always be something that the abusive partner will find
yeah.
to go ahead and go into the second stage, which is the actual battering episode.
Certainly.
If the eggs are not cooked right, if the toast is burned, if she doesn't come home,
they'll find some reason.
They'll find some reason. So everything that she does will never be enough. And then eventually something will set it off. They'll go into the battering stage, which is the second stage.
Yeah, I understand.
And then after that is over, then they go into the third stage, which is what we call the honeymoon stage, where he is remorseful, he is sorry, he sees what has happened, she sees what has happened. The second stage, and he's, honey, I'm sorry, you know, I'll never do it again. You just make me so angry when you
yeah, sure, I
talk
understand.
Back to me, or when you are late, or when you...
And this stuff is all... I mean, I've heard all of this before. I've read all this before. This is very textbook-type stuff, isn't it?
Everybody
should be able to identify themselves or their partner with these kinds of guidelines, I would think.
Well, oftentimes, because it's a pattern of behavior, people
yeah.
don't necessarily recognize it until someone who is removed from the situation, i.e. a hotline counselor, a battering counselor, who knows neither them or their partner, says... Does this happen? And then does this happen?
All right, Leah, I want to ask you another question.
Okay.
What would you call a person who agrees with you on every single thing you've said there,
mm-hmm.
who also agrees with the check, who also does not subscribe to any of the potential batterer's checklist questions, which I'm sure you're familiar with, who doesn't do any of those things, but at one or two times in his life has hit a woman with an open hand once because he felt that he had been pushed over the brink very seriously and for a period of time.
Well, what I would suggest to anyone who feels that they have been in that situation is that because you have open hand slapped your partner
one time,
slapped them into a wall, one time, two times maybe, say in a period of 10 years, that does not necessarily make you a batterer.
Uh-huh.
But there is a predisposition towards using violence as a method of resolving conflict in mm-hmm. the relationship. And I would suggest that the person that is afraid that they're exhibiting these tendencies to look into it.
No, I don't. I'm not talking about a person that's afraid of it. I'm merely talking about a person who I'm talking about myself.
Okay.
And I think that I would resist any suggestion that I in any way am abusive to women on any level. But over a 25-year period, I have hit a woman on two occasions with an open hand. It was a slap. And I am not an abusive person in any way.
Well, let me ask you this: whether you feel stimulated that? I mean, you would obviously say that she provoked you to that episode.
Yes, but very seriously provoked me. I mean, I was a study in forbearance. I'm not going to let you put me into a category with all these other people because I think at the bottom line it trivializes the real problem. I'm not a problem, but I have done that.
You have done that.
Yeah.
And, well, I think the first thing is that you have an awareness. You're sensitive to that issue, and you're sensitive to what is wrong with that behavior.
Uh-huh.
I'm assuming that you did not like the fact that you behaved or acted out.
No, of course not.
Okay, and I think that's the first thing, is to recognize that you have the ability to do that. I would not necessarily put them in the category of batterer,
mm-hmm.
but just keep in mind that you have the potential to explode.
Okay, let me ask you one more quick question, and then we'll ring off.
Okay.
I see that the quote, this is not a quote from your executive director, it's from some kind of a counselor. I don't even know whether you agree with it. Quote, a lot of times people don't honestly recognize what this behavior is. It's learned behavior. Is it learned behavior?
Well, we do know that violence is learned behavior, and if it is learned, that it can.
I know that, but I'm not talking about violence. I'm talking about domestic violence. I'm talking about hitting women.
Yeah, it's definitely a learned behavior.
Are you saying it's a learned behavior simply because it's violence? Or is there, do you see what I'm getting at here? I'm trying to figure out whether in your mind there are people who learn it's okay or they're going to hit women.
Oh, well, yeah, absolutely. There are people who...
Not men, but women.
There are people... I'm sorry, I'm not clear. Are there women who are going to batter?
No. I'm going to have to put you in the cooler, Leah, and I'll get back to you. No, the question is real simple. It's textbook again. We don't need to waste any time on the fact that violence is learned. If you see it in your home, there's a very good chance that you are going to imitate it. I recognize all that. We don't even need to waste a split second on it. But I did not know that anyone considered hitting women exclusively, batting around your woman, to be a learned behavior. So I'm wanting to know what you can say about people who do hit women, men who hit women, but don't hit anybody else. That's the distinction I'm trying to make, and we'll get your answer in just a moment. It's 1244 at King 1090.
Middays with Rick Miller on King News Talk 1090. The following is an actual lotto fantasy. The name has been changed, well, because we like funny names. Case number 17, Sabrina Sue Finkelfritz. The prom.
If I won that next big lotto jackpot, I'd fly in all my old high school classmates and recreate the senior prom. This time we'll do it right. Instead of staying home and watching TV, Beverly Baranowski will get an invitation from that cute guy in metal shop. I'll buy Teresa Colangelo a really nice dress to replace that horrible blue sequin thing she wore last time. I'll book the real Disco Kings instead of that cheesy band that tried to sound like them. And I'll make sure that awful Robbie Berman doesn't sneak up behind guys and give them wedgies while they're spooning punch. Just give me one more shot at prom magic.
Got a fantasy? With a lotto ticket, you're just six numbers away from making it happen. Must be 18. Odds of winning 1 in 7 million. Lotto from the Washington State Lottery.
The next lotto jackpot is worth $5 million. Feel lucky?
Hold the phone. What's all the hullabaloo about one more number in the U.S. West Direct Yellow Pages? Why, it's the number for U.S. West Easy Source. With one local call, you can find out almost everything about weather conditions, market conditions, the condition of your favorite team. Learn a lot about investments, about computers, real estate, even health concerns. From modems to mortgages, mutual funds to mammograms, it's all a call away with Easy Source. And what's this universe of knowledge cost? Hey, what's the cost of a free local call? Trick question, nothing. If you've got questions, Easy Source has answers. It's only in your U.S. West Direct Yellow Pages. Easy Source from U.S. West.
This is a very special announcement. Tomorrow from 9 a.m. until 9 p.m., you can save an additional 15% off almost everything at Lamont's. Now, what you need to remember is that the key word here is additional. Even if something is already on sale, you can save an additional 15% on top of the sale price. For instance, if something at Lamont's is on sale for 30% off, you can save an additional 15% on top of the 30% off sale price. Which makes tomorrow the perfect time to stock up on all the things you need for summer. Well, you know, lightweight tops, great little knits, terrific shorts, and swimwear. And Lamont's has all of this great fashion for every member of the family. So bring everyone, because tomorrow you can save an additional 15% off nearly everything at Lamont's, with very few exclusions. The hours are 9 to 9, the day is Saturday, the place is Lamont's, and the savings are sensational. Save an additional 15% off almost each and every purchase at only one store, Lamont's.
We talk about the issues and what they mean to you. King News Talk 1090.
1247 at King 1090. I'm Rick Miller. Leah Aldrich, the communications director for the Los Angeles Commission on Assaults Against Women, has joined us on the telephone for a very brief conversation. And Leah, I did pose a question just before that little break, but I understand you did not hear the question.
I'm sorry, I was very unclear in the question.
Okay.
I think that some of my confusion is that you're making a distinction between domestic violence and violence.
Let me restate the question and see if we can get there.
Okay.
I clearly realize that violence is a learned behavior and a problem beyond doubt, and that's textbook stuff. We don't need to waste even a split second talking about it. All reasonable people understand that. What I did not know, and what seems to be being said here, and I'm asking you about, is, are there? I did not know that hitting women specifically was a learned response, which leads to the big question in my mind: are there men out there who hit women? They do not hit men.
Right.
Let me ask the question.
Okay.
They hit women only, and is that a learned behavior?
Have you ever heard of something called the rule of thumb?
No, I guess not.
Okay, there is a cliche catchphrase that we use in our society called, you know, when we're trying to establish something as being status quo, we say, well, the rule of thumb is, okay?
Yeah.
And for those people out there, I'm sure there are people who know this. Rule of thumb is part of early English common law, which states that a man may beat his horse and wife with objects, as long as they are no larger than the width of his thumb. Okay?
Yeah.
That is the rule of thumb.
Okay, well, that's obviously a law whose time has come to be extinct.
What's the point here? The point is, given the fact that our society is established based on what we know to be an English society that came before us, okay?
Yeah.
That has been indoctrinated, inculcated, and made systematic in the way that male-female relationships are established in this country.
You mean you're thinking that there are males out there who think it's okay to hit women?
Absolutely. Evidently. I mean, 4 million women every year go to hospital emergency rooms as a result of some injury that they receive at the hands of their spouse.
What you seem to be using by your rule of thumb example is that those men, those brutes, those savages that are doing that seem to think that they actually think it's okay. They don't think it's a weakness or a
Well, oftentimes no one has intervened and told them that, hey, you cannot do this.
Okay. To return to the original question, perhaps you don't know the answer, and it's perfectly okay. In your mind, is hitting women a learned response?
Yes. Now, I think that you can...
Or a learned behavior, I should say.
But whether it be implicitly taught or explicitly taught,
mm-hmm.
is I think the argument here, or where the distinction needs to be drawn, is that when young males are taught that, hey, you got to keep your girlfriends in line,
yeah,
and you got to do whatever it takes to keep her in line,
yeah,
you got to discipline your girlfriends, you got to discipline your wives,
and there are actually people. What percentage of the people of the men in this country do you think subscribe to that line?
I couldn't tell you.
You haven't got a clue?
I know that estimations of as many as 52% of the women in this country have at some time been in abusive relationships.
But that's the whole thing. See, I don't believe those statistics. That's the exact point. In fact, I made this point yesterday. I don't know if you're referring to the same study that I read, which I think is absolutely bogus and has no, there's no statistics or data to support it. I don't believe that. And that's why it is so important to find out what people are talking about before they bandy about the idea that 52% of women are getting batted around.
I understand where you're coming from, and I hear you, and I appreciate the fact that you brought that up, because when we had two psychologists in the local Los Angeles area use statistics to create a backlash in terms of the domestic violence movement, in terms of, well, women beat men up just as much as
that's
men.
The article I'm referring to.
And you know, we have a problem with that, but that's another radio show, radio program.
Yeah, sure.
The realization of the fact that because one woman, is battered, all right, it's one woman too many, all right? In Los Angeles County, when we have 20,000 reported incidents of domestic violence, those are the ones that are reported, okay? Those are the ones that are documented
through
our city attorney's office.
Yeah.
So we know that there is a problem.
I'm not denying. I mean, I hope you don't think for a split second that I'm denying that there's a problem. Right. But as usual with me,
notions from somewhere.
Pardon me.
The people that batter are getting these ideas that it is okay to batter your partner.
Yeah, I suppose they are.
Control their behavior. They're learning it from somewhere. Whether they learned it from their fathers, whether they learned it because they grew up in a household that was violent, whether they're getting it from their peers saying, "Hey, man, keep her in line."
Amazing.
Or whether they are being influenced by media. Whether they are being made, you know, because of substance abuse.
It's happening. Okay, I do get it, Leah. Thank you very much. We are very much up against a problem here time-wise. I want to thank you very much for the time spent with us, and good luck to you.
You're welcome. Good luck to you, too.
Thank you very much. It's 1252 at King 1090.
Will you marry me? No, I can't say that. That's too direct. I was thinking of getting married, and I wondered if...
You've got enough to worry about when it comes to planning your wedding. So stop into Menashe & Sons Jewelers in West Seattle for their annual diamond sale, including 30% off all of their beautifully styled wedding ring sets. Plus, with your wedding set purchase, you'll receive a free groom's ring from a selection of handsome 14-karat gold rings. That's right, free. And to make those wedding plans easier, you'll also receive a bridal savings package, including complimentary flowers, tuxedo, a video wedding planner, and even a $100 gift certificate from Mowry's Photography in West Seattle. Stop in today for incredible diamond values and enter to win a Northwest getaway for two. Menashe & Sons Jewelers annual diamond sale. It's a brilliant way to celebrate the beginning or the continuation of your lives together. Convenient financing is available. For more information, call 932-4272. Menashe & Sons Jewelers, in the heart of the West Seattle Junction, just minutes from downtown Seattle.
Remember back when you were a kid, you could sleep anywhere, wake up bright-eyed and bushy-tailed? That doesn't last forever, and at my age especially, it seems like the whole day brings aches, pains, and fatigue. Lots of people have discovered adjustable beds. They're so helpful for those with chronic physical conditions. And for many others, the adjustable bed means a truly restful night's sleep and more energy the next day and every day. Beautyrest has been America's first name in sleep products for over 100 years. And Beautyrest is the perfect design for an adjustable bed coupled with powerful motors and precision gears. Raise your head, your shoulders, or your legs. Have a relaxing body massage. The adjustable bed is the ultimate and incomparable night's sleep. Stop by any of Sleep Country's 13 stores for a demonstration or call for the Sleep Country USA no-obligation adjustable bed video. 1-800-745-SLEEP. They'll send it to you right away. No salesman will call. They'll just send you the free video. 1-800-745-7533.
The following is an actual lotto fantasy. The name has been changed, well, because we like funny names. Case number 93, Elmer H. Berry Dipper, Superfan.
Hi. If I won that next big lotto jackpot, I'd buy a dozen yellow shirts, bright yellow shirts, bright yellow shirts with epaulettes on the shoulders. Then I'd go to all the big sporting events wearing a bright yellow shirt. I'd be at center ice for the finals, behind home plate for the playoffs, and at ringside for championship fights. I'll be on TV all the time, in the background, in a bright yellow shirt. Viewers will wonder, who's that yellow shirt guy? Why is he always there? I'll be a folk hero. Yes, a veritable media darling at all the games in a bright yellow shirt. That's my fantasy, America. Don't say I didn't warn you.
Got a fantasy? With a lotto ticket, you're just six numbers away from making it happen. Must be 18. Odds of winning 1 in 7 million. Lotto from the Washington State Lottery.
The next lotto jackpot is worth $5 million. Feel lucky? You can join King News Talk 1090 on the Information Superhighway. Talk with King 1090 hosts and management using your personal computer through America Online. Our address is simply King 1090. If you're a user of one of the many other online services, such as Prodigy or CompuServe, you can email King 1090 through the internet at king1090@aol.com. We'd love to hear your comments and suggestions on King 1090 programming, so get online with King 1090.
1256 of King 1090. Bonnie, are you going to say, is it your position that O.J. Simpson is innocent and he's being framed?
That's right.
All right, Bonnie, then I want to put you in the cooler and I will start the next hour with you.
All right.
Stay right there. Don't you dare go away. John in Redmond, you're on King 1090.
Yeah, just a couple of things. When you asked whether it was learned,
yeah,
I don't think it's learned, but I think it's heavily reinforced. Go back and watch your old Clark Gable movies, especially in The Last Generation.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, there are numerous instances of Clark Gable, you know, just hauling off and decking some woman. In the 20s, the first crossover hit song had this rather scandalous title, It's a Shame to Beat Your Wife on Sunday When You've Got Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday.
Yeah, I know, and there's all the references sports stars have made, I go home and beat my wife and all that, but I say to all of that, what possible relevance is that in 1994, and who could possibly believe that it's okay in 1994 unless they were predisposed towards beating the hell out of their woman anyway?
Well,
you know?
You ask the question. You know, is it learned? It's reinforced. There's tons and tons of stuff that reinforces this, that counteracts all the, you know, the material that is against it.
That make it seem okay.
Well, and the point is, people pick and choose the things that they listen to according to their predisposition.
Uh-huh.
Just like you're doing.
Do you think that I lost it.
Oh, the other thing is, I think alcohol plays a tremendous
part I do too.
In the run-of-the-mill kind of call that you're talking about, you know, to the cops.
Yeah.
And I think that there must be some very high proportion of men that would never be involved in this except that alcohol or some other substance reduces their inhibitions just enough to get them started. And once they start, it's very hard to stop.
No, I understand that. I must say, I have a very hard time believing that there is any man over maybe 5-10% of the audience that there's who are nuts. There's always going to be 5 or 10% that screw up everything, no matter what. But the rest of the people that smack women, I can't imagine that they don't know how terrible it is, that they don't know it's wrong, and would want to quit.
Well, they do, or I'm sure that many of them know it's wrong. Something has to intervene to, first of all, you have to stop them. And then something has to touch them in a way where they recognize what's happening. You know, they know it's happening. They can see it being wrong with somebody else. But, you know, you can always rationalize your own case.
Do you know anybody that beats women?
Well, my father was a batterer.
Oh, okay. So you have some firsthand knowledge.
Yeah, and he was a tremendously strong, powerful athlete. He would never hurt anyone. He was the nicest person on earth.
Except
when he
Quick.
Drank.
Oh, except when he drank. Great call, John. Thank you very much. Listen, in the next hour, I want to talk to any man or woman out there, anyone who thinks it's okay to hit a woman under any circumstances. I want to speak to you. Give me a call. And we'll start the show, the hour, by the way, with someone who thinks O.J.'s being framed. But now the news, 1 o'clock, King 1090.
Seattle's news talk station with balance and variety. King News Talk 1090, KING, Seattle.
Here's the latest from ABC News. I'm Linda Moore.
We got a deal.
With everybody?
All aboard.
Republican Senator John Chafee of Rhode Island is talking about a bipartisan health reform plan that would insure most Americans by the year 2002.
We're very pleased that the group that from the Finance Committee, composed of Democrats and Republican senators, have reached an agreement on a proposal that we think makes very, very significant advances for health care in the United States of America.
Under the plan, if 95% of Americans don't have health insurance within the next 8 years, a special commission would recommend how to boost coverage. If that fails, then people would have to buy their own insurance, and low-income people would get help. Most Americans prefer family doctors to specialists. That's one finding of a survey for the Kellogg Foundation.
61% believe that they can get nearly all of the health care they need from a family doctor or basic care provider. Just one in four believe that of medical specialists.
Pollster Celinda Lake, the poll of 1,000 registered voters, has a 3% margin of error. Now this.
Want to learn a foreign language? Get out your suitcase, pack your SOCKS. In just 30 days, National Dynamics will have you speaking and understanding Spanish, French, German, Italian, or Japanese guaranteed or your money back. Order a complete set today and choose either a free cassette player or free travel club membership good for discounts on airfares, cruises, and hotels. National Dynamics is the best way to get from here to anywhere. Call 1-800-545-1985 for details. 1-800-545-1985.
America, get rockin' and cookin' with Kraft, Oscar Mayer, and Lewis Rich. Wolf Manzak here telling you to get rockin' with up to $10 in savings at Musicland and Sam Goody. Save up to $10 on CDs and cassettes when you get cookin' with your family's favorite foods. Buy any three Kraft cheese products, 8 ounces or larger, Oscar Mayer bologna, or Lewis Rich cold cuts, and you can save up to $10 on the music you want to hear. Get details in the mail-in form at the rockin' and cookin' display in participating grocery stores now.
King News Talk 1090, midday news update.
102, King News Talk 1090. Good afternoon. I'm Tony Miner in the King 1090 News Center. Here's what's going on today. Seattle's new police chief wants to do something about domestic violence. Norm Stamper saying today he's forming a special domestic violence task force. He also said he was very upset by the 911 tapes in the Simpson case.
We can hear the fear. We can hear it in people's voices, and we understand that there is so much damage that can be done in a home before the police ever arrive, assuming that they're called.
Stamper says this new domestic violence unit will focus on training police officers who are called in when violence erupts in people's homes. The O.J. Simpson case has prompted a lot more calls to local helplines. More on that part of the story now from King 1090's Jane Shannon.
Since the O.J. Simpson case broke, domestic violence hotlines have been ringing off the hook in the Seattle area.
I've heard more women calling our agency in our community advocacy office, and I know over in the east side they've also experienced a great increase in women realizing how unsafe they are.
Beryl Adrian is with the agency New Beginnings in Seattle. She's happy women are breaking their silence because it may ultimately save their lives. Jane Shannon, King News Talk, 1090.
An unusual cause of a fire today. Sunlight is being blamed for starting a fire at a house under construction in Woodinville. Firefighters say a beam of sunlight was magnified by a pane of glass, and that ignited a stack of carpet remnants. Damage estimated at $20,000. 104, King News Talk 1090. A look at traffic and weather together coming up next.
My 3-year-old, Claire, loves her new plastic scissors. So this week, when I brought in the mail, she was happy to see that...
105, coming up on 106 now at King 1090. The Rick Miller Show on a Friday. I have a fax here, which I will honor a little bit later. I want to get to Bonnie in just a moment, but the facts basically says all of us in this office need to know what those two women did to cause you to think you should slap them. I will, I guess that is probably interesting, and I will give both, I will give the answer on both counts during this segment sometime, I promise you. But I don't want to let Bonnie get away here. By the way, the phone number 441-5464 is the number in Seattle, 1-800-833-5464. That's the number throughout the state. Toll free at star 1090 if you have a cell one phone. And if you want to fax us, that number is 448-1840. Bonnie in Seattle, you're on King 1090 with a theory about O.J. Simpson's innocence?
Right.
Go ahead.
I feel that O.J. Simpson is innocent. Reason being is because I focus a lot on the Rodney King incident. And the Rodney King incident, there were policemen that were prosecuted behind it. And the Los Angeles Force didn't like that. And so I feel that they took somebody who they claimed was a hero, they looked back at his past, and they pulled out O.J., who's supposed to be a hero, and they took it on, and they're making a big rage out of it. Because anybody, we are all human beings. And if you go out there and you commit a crime, you get them for it. You pull them in, you prosecute them. You just don't parade it down and make a big parade out of it.
What parade are we talking about?
I mean, I'm talking about when they had all the big scene on TV and he's a hero and all this, you know. I feel that the police are behind all of it.
What did the police do?
Did they
kill Nicole Simpson?
Well, no. Well, I feel that they have something to do with this, okay?
Who do you think killed Nicole Simpson?
I don't know. I don't know who killed Nicole Simpson, but I believe that somebody within the police force has a lot of play in this role.
You mean, well, it sounds like there's a conspiracy then that you're concerned about.
I'm just saying that the police force down there has a lot to do with it.
All right, buddy. Thank you very much. I wanted to get that out there. I had high hopes. But what can I say? I don't think there is a scintilla. Look, I want to talk to people who think it's okay to hit a woman. I can't imagine that there is very many people. I have said and believe many times before that we need laws for the 10%. Of the people who are uneducable and simply will not act like decent human beings. That's the only reason we need laws. We probably need some other rules and regulations to keep good people in line so they're not just doing their thing all the time. But the real laws are needed for the 10%. Now, if you're going to tell me that 10% of men hit women and think it's okay, I won't argue with you at all, because I imagine that's true, because it takes all kinds, and we know that 10% of the population, which, let's face it, 10% of the population is 25 million people. Half of a men, that's 12, 13 million men. Half the percentage of half the 10% of the males, that's millions and millions of people. That's a lot. I mean, good God, that's how many people listen to Rush Limbaugh, for God's sakes. And you know what a bozo he is. Anyway, I can't argue about that, but I really do. It's not that I reject or resist the idea that there are more than that who hit women and think it's okay. I would just be shocked if it was more than that. I can't believe that anyone outside that 10% who has smacked a woman or systematically beats women thinks it's okay. Feels anything but terrible remorse and a firm purpose not to do it again. And if they do it again, would check himself into the care unit or whatever. I mean, I can't imagine otherwise. And yet you talk to people who are the heads of battered households and the battered women and they say shelters, and they say, oh yeah, there's this and that, but I need credible evidence. We had that article yesterday that I pretty well excoriated, I think, where they say 52% of women are battered or something. Is that what it was? 52% of the women are battered? What nonsense. I mean, how in the hell do you come up with a crazy figure like that? Those are my thoughts anyway. So the point is, anybody that thinks it's okay to hit a woman, please call me. I want to talk to you about that. Very quickly, I'll tell you real quick the two instances where I slapped a woman, both times with an open hand. One time I'm about 16, 17 years old. I'm in love with this gal. Oh, God, did I love her. And we had our, she was kind of volatile. In fact, I sort of am drawn to volatile women, I guess. And I'm sort of volatile myself, I guess, at certain times. And anyway, where she had really annoyed me. We were bickering back and forth, blah, blah, blah. And we were driving in a car, and she started, hitting me, not hard, but I'm driving the car, and she was smacking me a little bit, not hurting me, but she was really, and so I backhanded her. I backhanded her, and my intent really wasn't to hit her in the face. My intent was just to stop her with a shoulder blow, a backhand, and I got her in the face. And one time, and felt terrible about it, and she was mad as hell, and then she really beat me up. Anyway, that was the one time I was 16, 17 years old, and I regret that, but I'm not ashamed of it. And the other time was with the woman that I told that story about last week, where that big fight that I had and all that stuff. She and I had a volatile relationship for a long time, and she was just as volatile as I was. And as a matter of fact, when her hot button was hit, it was really a lights out. I can't imagine, I can't tell you how bad it was, how bad it could be. And she was pretty well working me over, and I did smack her with one hand in the face to slow her down, just to stop her. And that worked. That was all it took to stop it, and there was nothing further. I'm not proud of either of those incidences. I wish that they had not happened, but I certainly am not ashamed of them, and I do not feel that it in any way makes me a closet batterer or someone that needs to see a psychiatrist or anything else. And if the shelter units are saying, oh, yeah, Rick Miller, he just said on the radio that he's slapped a woman twice, well, he's in that statistic now, and maybe that's how you get to 52%. And it's BS. It's just another example of not describing a problem accurately, and when you don't, you can't possibly know the truth about something. I don't think one penny of resources on, as far as battered women are concerned, should be wasted on talking to me. There's bigger fish to fry. I'm not even in the frying pan. That's my thought. That's my idea. That's my belief. Stephanie in Seattle, you're...
But there is some special drive, some special quality to these men. They need things to be on their terms.
Are you talking about athletes now?
Yes.
Okay.
They focus very hard on their sport, on their bodies, on their, what they're trying to achieve.
Yeah.
And this can lead to small things that normal people wouldn't be frustrated at, but they will get frustrated.
Because and that will lead them to... were you married to such a person?
Yes.
Are you married to such a person?
No, not anymore.
Okay, so you were married to a professional white athlete who beat you?
Not so much that. It was more verbal abuse, and then toward the end of our relationship, when his he was starting to... his body was becoming more human, and he was having some physical...
problems. Yeah.
And then that was very hard to take. The fear of failing himself was more important to him, harder to handle than failing me.
Was he a football player?
No, baseball.
Baseball player. Okay. So what's your real point? What's your main point? That athletes are given to this?
I wouldn't say that they're given to that. I would say that there is a definite potential for this type of behavior. He left me, and that wasn't because he didn't love me and didn't want me. It was more this fear of failing or the fact that I might leave him if he couldn't provide what he thought he should provide in a way of lifestyle or whatever.
Okay, did he ever physically smack you?
Yes, right at the end of our relationship.
How many times?
A couple times. But okay. He did push me, grab me, or something like that other times.
Pushed you and grabbed you. But
right.
You would you consider yourself to be a battered woman? Physically?
At the time, I didn't.
Do you now?
Well, my second husband was worse, so I considered that more of a battering.
Your second husband batted you around?
Mm-hmm.
Is he? Are you still married to him?
No.
Are you married to anyone else?
Yes.
For
8 years, very happily, and there's no hitting.
Stephanie, I have a few more questions for you. Will you go in the cooler?
Sure.
Stay right there. We'll get back to Stephanie and the rest of your calls in just a moment. It's 116 at King 1090.
Hi, Rich. What's up?
You know what's up, Bruce. It's that time again here at Ballard Camera.
No, say it isn't so.
It is so. The dreaded inventory. Oh. End of the fiscal year kind of thing.
Uh-huh.
It's coming up June 30th.
And?
We've got a whole warehouse full of Canon cameras, lenses, that kind of thing. And I don't want to count them.
Neither do I. Hey, Rich.
Yo.
Evan's out of town.
Mm-hmm.
We could have a big sale.
Let's offer everybody some great deals on all this Canon merchandise. Like the Canon SureShot A1.
Ah, the compact, lightweight, stylish, waterproof 35mm camera with precise active smart autofocus.
Yeah.
Panorama mode.
Mm-hmm.
Underwater operation guaranteed to depth of 16.4 feet.
That's the Canon SureShot A1, Bruce.
And Rich, we've got to get rid of the gadget banks.
Yep.
Let's do 50% off.
Sounds good. Let's tell everybody to get down here to Ballard Camera right now. Help us clear out all this Canon stuff so we don't have to count it for inventory.
They can save on all kinds of merchandise.
There's only one other thing.
And what would that be?
You got to tell them the address.
Oh, yeah. 1836 Northwest Market. Ballard Camera in the heart of downtown Ballard.
Yeah.
12 years ago, the folks at Red Hook began brewing unique beverages, first in Ballard and later in Fremont. Their goal was to take the finest, freshest Northwest ingredients and brew them in accordance with the highest standards of the brewer's art. In so doing, they also helped start a national trend toward quality ale that has yet to peak. These days, Red Hook produces a full range of specialty beers to satisfy the most discriminating beer drinker. Each and every style is fresh and unpasteurized. The Red Hook Brewery in Fremont welcomes visitors for tours and a taste of fine, fresh ale. The fact is that people have come to enjoy Red Hook ale so much that, by late summer, a new brewery in Woodinville will be open to fill the demand for specialty beers made without compromise. Remember, beer is best when fresh, so drink hometown beer. Drink Red Hook. Proud to be a part of the Northwest beverages that have captured the nation's attention and thirst.
You need to start your day informed. But does the news have to be so depressing? I mean, let's face it, sometimes it's pretty grim stuff. Crime and violence, politicians, the deficit, even killer bees. That's why we created the King 1090 Morning News. Sure, we've got all the news, even the killer bees. But we also offer the humor of Pat Cashman from Almost Live. News with a sense of humor? Why not? Sometimes the best way to deal with real life is to laugh.
Pat Cashman and Company. A fresh new look at the news on King News Talk 1090. Don't settle for one side of the story. Get balanced news talk with variety. King News Talk 1090.
At King 1090, I'm Rick Miller, reminding you that new callers are always welcome on the radio show. I would like to give the phone numbers in my official, one of my official duties as a talk radio host. 441-5464 is the number in Seattle. 1-800-833-5464. That's the number throughout the state. Toll free at star 1090 if you have a cell one phone and if you want a fax. 448-1840. I happen to make the mistake of glancing upward. We have a television set on. I usually like to watch the cartoons during my show. The World Cup is on. What a bogus event. I know that the World Cup is... I saw the World Cup in Australia, and I thought, hey, what's this? When does the real football start? Anyway, they have sold America, or trying to sell the idea to America, that soccer is interesting. I got to tell you, I don't think it's all that interesting. We have a few people around here who are nuts for it. Sean's playing one of them. But I think it's, I think that this is America showing very good taste in resisting this nonsense. Consider it to be absolute nonsense. What was that other thing I was going to do? Oh, take a phone call. Stephanie in the... Thank you, Sean. You know, I'm 34 years old. I haven't lost my mind or my marbles just yet. Stephanie, now...
Yes?
Thank you for waiting, my dear young lady.
Huh?
I was a little confused on the chronology here. You have been married 3 times.
Yes.
Okay, your first marriage was to a professional baseball player.
Right. We met in college, and his career was developing, and I was there in the early part of his career.
Okay. And this ended up in some abuse. It would strike me as low-grade abuse late in the relationship.
That's basically it. And it stemmed more out of his own fear and frustrations at, developing calcium deposits. And
well, sure, I understand. But nonetheless, the way he met that challenge, that stress, was to smack you. I'm very interested in what goes on in people's minds when they have stress in one area. I mean, for an example, I have stress in my area right now because, I mean, this job might dry up and I may not go to Dallas.
Oh,
so
no.
Is it okay for me to smack women? Because I have stress, too. Sean Splane has stress because he has to work with me. That is as stressful as it gets. So should he go home and smack his wife?
And what about the listeners?
Stephanie, you have upped the ante in a most unbecoming fashion.
I'm sorry.
Now, Stephanie, so getting back to the chronology, now here was where my confusion was. You got married a second time. I thought you had been married to a black athlete, but the second husband is black, or
is
was black.
And, I went back to finish my college, met him. He was, in pre-med and all that, helped him get a good way through school.
Yeah.
He was athletic, but athletics were not his primary
Okay, but you made the point, I believe, to Barbara Nombele, who was who's helping me on with production duties today.
Uh-huh.
You made the point to her that you felt that there was something. Well, what did you say to Barbara?
That I had experience with battering from a black husband.
And you thought that well, see, I'm trying to get you to say it so I don't have to say it. And that you thought that what about that?
Well, basically, it wasn't that way early in the relationship, but it became something that became okay.
What conclusion did you draw?
A conclusion that I drew was that I couldn't live with it.
Okay,
I guess I'll have to leave.
Okay, I have to carry the water myself then. correct me if I'm wrong. My understanding, the information that was given to me, was that you felt that black men feel it is more acceptable to smack a woman than white men do. Is that correct or incorrect?
Well, in my case, I would say that my black husband felt less bad about it than my white husband.
Would you, in your experience,
it just became sort of a habitual thing. You know, when he was frustrated or tired or upset. I mean, even his brother came to our apartment and their sister was staying with us for a short period of time, and his brother came very late at night, had been drinking, and wanted more money from his sister, and my husband wasn't home, and so I had to deal with this, and the brother started in on the sister, and I had to try to intervene somehow, and then I got it. I mean, I got the worst punch in the stomach I've ever had.
From the brother or
from my brother-in-law. Because I was trying to tell him to, cool it with his sister. Because she was saying, I only have this much money. He's saying, I know you always have more than that.
Mm-hmm.
So it was something that if they don't have their way or they don't have their demands, and these are educated.
I think.
And not people who grew up in a ghetto somewhere.
I think there is something in the I was hoping that you would say this. I'll say it, and I want to preface this by saying, listen very carefully to exactly what I say. So when you howl in protest and call me a racist, you're calling me a racist for the right reasons, for what I say, not for what you think I say. Based on my experience, what I have been able to observe and read and inquire about, it would seem to me that black men and women, for that matter, but particularly men because they're stronger, are more prone to violence towards others because, and I don't know exactly why, but I think it's very possible that it is inculcated in as a virtue because they feel that they have to be tougher to overcome the problems. And one of the ways to be tougher is to be able to take a getting smacked every now and then. Now, that's my own analysis. That is nonetheless the way
to... Giving smacks.
giving smacks. Giving smacks. I mean, I think you see more of that in the black community. And I think that it is not, I don't think it's because they're black. I think you'll see more of that among poor people. People who are up against it, people who feel they are up against it. They have to be tougher. It's the boy named Sue syndrome. It's Johnny Cash singing that I knew I wasn't going to be around. You're entering a very tough world where it's very difficult and the odds are arrayed against you. Therefore, you must be tough. In the boy named Sue, I'm not going to smack you myself, but I'm going to name you Sue so that other people smack you. And you'll get tough that way. Now, I've said that exactly the way I mean it. People can grab any part of that they wish. You think there's any truth to it?
I think there is some truth to what you're saying. I still have to come back to my point, though, that it's something not necessarily, it's something that seemed to cross all strata of society.
I'll buy that. I don't want to get hung up on this. I was making one observation because I thought that when you called, you were making that specific point, which now you're either not or backing off of or whatever.
No, I don't think I'm backing off of it. I'm
okay.
Just saying that in my experience that it was more prevalent when I was associated more with black people. And,
well, that's what I was just, and that's what I was
right,
elaborating on.
Right, right.
Yeah.
So I would say that was my personal experience.
You don't want to say that, though, do you? You have a problem with that, don't you?
I wouldn't, you know, because I liked the people, I loved the family. It was just an aspect that was there that, you know, wasn't something that I was ever used to.
Mm-hmm.
And as it started to come out during the time period we were together, then that was something that I tried to deal with. First, it shocked me.
Okay, and you have, but everything is, you've now been married for 8 years to someone who does not do that, and your life, you have a placid life now.
Oh, yes, definitely.
Great.
Definitely.
Good deal. Thank
but
you.
But my current husband had a wife who was very upsetting and basically violent.
Yeah.
So first thing he said to me is, I don't want that kind of relationship. And I said, no, you won't have it with me.
Okay, Stephanie, thank you.
Uh-huh.
Good luck to you, and thank you very much. It's 128 at King 1090.
Rick Miller on King News Talk 1090.
When was the last time you treated yourself to a professional therapeutic massage while listening to some of the world's best music? Well, you can do that at Sound Touch, where Vicki Bliss is the licensed massage therapist. She is terrific. It's a combination of really great massage and music, which ends up in an incredibly relaxing and therapeutic experience. Vicki's massages are results-oriented. They're relaxing. She focuses on the areas of your body where you have problems, stress, tension, pain, whatever. She really zeroed in on some points in my legs where I really had problems. Using a combination of therapeutic massage techniques and the music, she's able to help you to release your pain and tension, feel rejuvenated and revived, and all in all, feel terrific. There's also a healing that goes on when you are given this kind of a massage. It's really good therapeutically and physically and mentally and all of that. She can take care of specific injury treatments or deep tissue massage or just give you a plain old relaxing massage. I'd call her if I were you. She's very reasonable and she's very good. It's Vicki Bliss. That's her name. And the company, our outfit is Sound Touch. Call for an appointment today. Conveniently located in Seattle near Tower Records and also on Vashon Island. Call 286-9054. That's Sound Touch. 286-9054.
King News Talk 1090, midday news update.
1:30, King News Talk 1090. Good afternoon. I'm Tony Miner in the King 1090 News Center. Lawyers for O.J. Simpson are trying an unusual move in a Los Angeles courtroom today. ABC's Bob Schmidt tells us what's going on.
It may be a last-ditch move by O.J. Simpson's lawyer to delay or possibly prevent the likelihood that a Los Angeles grand jury will indict O.J. in connection with the murders of his ex-wife Nicole and her friend Ronald Goldman. Robert Shapiro is using an unusual tactic. asking a judge for permission to test the impact on the grand jury of all the publicity about this case by questioning each of its 23 members. It's unusual because by law, grand jury proceedings are conducted in secret without any kind of input from the defense.
Meantime, the prosecutor disclosed a new piece of evidence today, a blue-knit cap found at the scene of the murder of Simpson's ex-wife Nicole and her friend Ronald Goldman. Well, forget the partisan bickering over health reform. A new plan put together by Democratic and Republican senators aims to provide coverage.
Outspoken, outrageous, out loud. Spend more of your midday with Rick Miller on King News Talk 1090.
134 at King 1090. I'm Rick Miller. I think it would be worthwhile to review very quickly the checklist of potential wife battering, the list for potential wife batterers to identify yourself, especially since I would like to talk to people who think it's okay to hit a woman. I want to talk to you if you think it's okay. I want to hear the way you're coming at this. And here's the checklist, and I've got to tell you that if you can say yes to any of these, if you say yes to any of these, I think you have a problem in that area. And if you are involved with someone who you say yes about to any of these, I think you have a problem too. You're going to get, if you haven't been batted around yet, you're going to be. And why would you want to be around such a controlling SOB anyway? Here's the checklist. See if you see yourself. Maybe you see yourself and you're proud of it. The checklist. Are you controlling? Do you expect her to conform to your time schedule and list of priorities? Do you have her call in and report to you? If she's not on time, do you get angry? Does your anger take over? Have you pushed, shoved, slapped, or hit her? Are you verbally abusive with words? Do you always feel like it's her fault? End of checklist. If you fit any of these, if you said yes to any of these, you definitely, I think, have something to be concerned about. If you said yes to two of them, you are probably going to bat around a woman, if you haven't already. And if you say yes to two of these, if you're involved with some man who you can say yes to two of these points, yes, he does that, yes, he does that, well, you better have a quick talk. I really mean that. Really mean that. All right. A special appearance of O.J. Simpson. We're going to be going to it right now. A special report. We'll go to it right now. It's 137 at King 1090. Everybody stay glued.
Coverage from ABC News. I'm John Belmont, and O.J. Simpson is back in court in Los Angeles this afternoon for the results of an emergency hearing that has been held earlier this afternoon to determine whether or not the grand jury that has been considering his murder case all this week was prejudiced by all the publicity of recent days, specifically the 911 tapes of Nicole Simpson's encounter with O.J. last fall that were released yesterday. Let's go right now live to that hearing. This is taking place in Los Angeles Criminal Courts Building. O.J. Simpson sitting there listening to the judge right now.
And the Los Angeles County Grand Jury, Los Angeles County District Attorney to recuse the grand jury to preclude any unintended consideration of prejudicial matters and to protect the due process rights of Mr. Simpson and the integrity of the grand jury process. And in the interests of fairness and justice to all involved, the court has ordered recusal of the 1993-94 grand jury from further consideration of this matter. The members of the 93-94 grand jury have been directed and ordered not to discuss this matter further among themselves or with any other person unless directed to do so by a court of competent jurisdiction over this matter. Now, this order was made without prejudice to the district attorney to proceed by way of indictment before a different grand jury or by way of preliminary hearing. And the Los Angeles County Council is directed to work with the Los Angeles District Attorney's Office and the court to develop procedures and additional admonitions to eliminate such concerns with regard to future proceedings. I am directing that a copy of my order of recusal in the grand jury proceedings be made a part of the file containing the motion that was filed in this court today under case BA-097211.
Simpson case, and we'll explain it to you in full in just a moment. But you may recall that a grand jury has been hearing evidence.
That's ABC's Peter Jennings, and as soon as we get further explanation, he's obviously working up a lawyer right now on just what this recusal means. But reading between the lines, it may be that the grand jury has been excused from considering the evidence against O.J. Simpson because of what's been going on the past couple of days, all the publicity. Simpson's lawyer, Robert Shapiro, was in court earlier today arguing that this prejudiced the case. He says, we feel the grand jury has been contaminated, he told the judge. It is virtually impossible, said Shapiro, for Mr. O.J. Simpson to receive a fair trial or a fair review before the grand jury. Let's go to the courtroom again now. This is Judge Ito.
Copies of the order that I have just read are available, and Marcia Skolnick, court's information officer, has, I believe, adequate copies for anyone who desires to have one. This matter that would appear to me to conclude the proceedings required by this matter, unless you have any other matters to raise at this time.
We do not. Thank you.
Welcome, court will be in recess.
Well, that's the hearing, and O.J. Simpson, because this is all legal talk so far, it has not been explained to him, and he's had no reaction. He's in court this afternoon wearing the same pinstripe dark blue suit and open-necked white shirt that he has been wearing. O.J. not allowed to wear a necktie because of the suicide watch. He's leaving the courtroom right now, and this brief hearing took place on short notice. ABC's Bob Schmidt is in Los Angeles. Bob, do you have a reading yet on exactly what this all means?
Well, this is really, it seems to me, a rather stunning development in favor of O.J. Simpson's defense. You know, they had come from way out in left field, going in and, in effect, asking the judge to remove this grand jury from the case because of comments that were made by the prosecution and because of comments made in connection with this case by others. It had been considered by observers to be a real long shot because initially the motion was to have the grand jurors questioned by perhaps the defense or by the judge as to whether they had been prejudiced.
Okay,
that did
Bob
not happen, and in the case which we now have before us, it appears that Judge Cecil Mills, the presiding judge of the Superior Court here, has taken this case out of the grand jury's hands entirely, and he did say that it would be possible to have another grand jury consider it. But considering also the preliminary hearing, which is coming up on the 30th of June, that would make it highly unlikely. Now we're going to get some comments, I think, from one of the prosecutors here.
Okay, so you're reading this at this moment the way I am, that when he talked about a recusal, much as a judge would recuse himself from a case and step down, this is being taken away from the grand jury.
It's being taken out of their hands entirely.
Let's see if we can get some of the sound from the hallway outside the courtroom. The cameras were not allowed inside during the closed hearing earlier today.
One of the prosecutors, David Kahn, is now commenting to reporters.
In this particular case, and it was as a result of his meeting with the supervising judge, that the judge took the action that he did, and that's all we can say about this at this time.
Why would you argue? Would there be another grand jury?
Grand jury will poll, actually pulled on this?
I'm sorry.
Is it still possible to seek a grand jury indictment?
If that's the case, David, then why was Marcia arguing against the motion?
Hedging his way out toward the elevator, not fielding any further questions from reporters. He didn't
answer that
say.
Question about another grand jury, and that is a key question.
Well, they wouldn't really have time, John, I think, before the 30th to impanel a grand jury and then have all the evidence presented that's been presented since, what, last Friday when this grand jury got the case. I think it would be extremely unlikely, given that time frame, that they could do that. So it does appear to be a victory for the defense in that now it appears they will have a chance to present their side of the story at a hearing, a preliminary hearing, which is scheduled for the 30th. At that point, then it would be up to the judge presiding over that hearing to decide if there was sufficient evidence to take O.J. Simpson to trial. The other scenario, which we now apparently will not see, would be to have an indictment, in which case the prosecution wouldn't have to subject its witnesses to cross-examination and go through all these other machinations of the law. Now it appears they will have to do that at the preliminary hearing. Bottom line, it appears at this point to be quite a clear-cut victory for the defense.
And if Bob Shapiro is trying to end all the pretrial publicity and all the leaks, he has scored a victory, because what will happen at that preliminary hearing next Thursday is that much of the evidence will be made public. I understand in California, preliminary hearings are, in effect, mini-trials.
Well, yes, they'll have to lay all their cards on the table, and especially, I think, the key point is challenging or using their right to challenge some of the witnesses. We'll get an idea who the witnesses are. A lot of this case will come up, and as you say, yes, I think that's a fair statement, John, that we would see sort of a mini trial here. So I think it does prolong the suspense in a way and make matters considerably more interesting than it.
And that, my friends, is why you get a high-priced lawyer. And when you get a high-priced lawyer, all bets are off. I'll explain. I understand exactly what's going on here. I'll explain the whole thing in just a moment. This is an incredible development in the O.J. Simpson case, and it is a phenomenal victory for O.J. Simpson and Robert Shapiro. Full explanation coming up. It's 145 at King 1090.
In some ways, maybe out.
This case, putting aside for a split second the terrible tragedy involved, this is going to be one of the most incredibly fascinating cases in the history of American jurisprudence to follow. Do you remember several days ago, Robert Shapiro, O.J. Simpson's lawyer, was making a big thing about how he wanted a preliminary hearing, not a grand jury indictment. He wanted the preliminary hearing because at a preliminary hearing, it's public. And you can cross-examine witnesses, and the American public can observe and see what's going on, and it's a very public thing. If you have a very popular public figure who you're defending, it is to your overwhelming advantage to show all this to the American people so as to drum up sympathy, especially as you cross-examine witnesses in the preliminary hearing. The grand jury, on the other hand, is done in secret. And if the grand jury decides an indictment is called for by a vote of 13 of the 24 members, the case simply goes to trial, and the public is none the wiser as far as the ins and outs and what was considered and all that. All they know is it's going to trial, and that's all. The preliminary hearing gives you the whys and wherefores. Shapiro wanted the preliminary hearing. What happened? Today, electrifying news. The judge, they call it a recusal. We've looked it up. We can't find it in the dictionary. Sean, look it up in your great big fat dictionary, the one that weighs 500 pounds. We're looking up recusal. We haven't been able to find it in our standard dictionaries, but Robert Shapiro, this is why you can buy justice. This is why you get the high-priced lawyers. This is why money talks. Shapiro has somehow, because of his incredible clout and brain power and staff and connections, has somehow convinced a judge to rule that as a result of the 911 tapes, the grand jury that is currently looking into the O.J. Simpson case in secret has been contaminated. That the grand jury has to be broken up. That this grand jury convening has been hopelessly contaminated, and can no longer consider this case fairly. The grand jury in this case is out of business. What are the options now? Well, isn't it amazing? The options are to reconvene a grand jury, fine, except that the preliminary hearing, which is what Shapiro wanted all along, has already been scheduled for June 30th, next week, much sooner than any grand jury could be convened. End result, Shapiro gets his way. There will be a preliminary hearing which will allow him Shapiro and O.J. Simpson and everybody connected with the defense of this case to shine, to become sympathetic, to put O.J. Simpson's state of mind and all that stuff out there for the American people, and to take full advantage in a public forum of O.J. Simpson's unbelievable popularity. And the grand jury is out of business. There will be no secret convening. There will be no indictment handed down. It will all be done through a preliminary hearing. This is an incredible victory for the defense. Incredible. It's unbelievable. I can scarcely believe it, to tell you the truth. We'll be back with your calls, by the way. I know you've been patient, and that's good. It's 151 at King 1090. The trouble for being a dunderhead or something. I want Shapiro as my lawyer. Jim in a car phone, you're on King 1090.
Hi, Rick.
Yes, Jim.
Yes. Do you think it's okay to slap a woman at any time?
Haven't I said about five times that I think it is terrible, it's awful, it's unbelievably bad? How can we waste airtime making me repeat my denials?
Okay, then what would you do under these circumstances? You make some verbal statements, a woman slaps you in the face, what would be your next move?
If she's going to continue to try and smack you, you should grab her hands. I've done that once or twice, too. Grab her hands, unless you want to take a few more smacks, which probably wouldn't hurt you too much. She's, after all, only a woman. But you certainly wouldn't hit her back.
Don't you think there's a benefit to keeping a level state of, rapport between you? In other words, that she knows that she can't just continuously hit you, even though you have no risk of injury in the long run, but couldn't it hurt the relationship by not...
Well, of course it can.
By not at least slapping her at least as hard as she...
What's that going to accomplish? Tell me.
It'll make both of you feel like they were equally, I don't know.
Equally what?
In pain for what happened. In other words, she slaps you to a certain degree, kind of a certain amount of stinging on your face.
So you sting her the same way?
Exactly the amount.
All right, I'm trying to figure that out right now. I mean, I reject it all, but I'm trying to come up. I don't think it's enough for me to reject it. I think I've got to come up with a good reason why, and that's the reason for my pause. I know that it's wrong. It's not right to inflict a stinging pain on a woman. It's just not.
I mean, I agree. Unless she initiates it herself.
I'm with you on that. I will give you, I think I can complete the answer. The reason that you must not do a quid pro quo deal, a tit for a tat, so to speak, the reason you can't do that is because if it escalates even past that, you have all the power and she doesn't, and you can do real damage and she doesn't, and she can't, and that is why it's on the bottom line, besides all the other bad things, it's simply unfair. It's not fair.
But an equal argument could be raised that will stop it from escalating. That's my whole point.
You mean in a split second? You mean that things are frenzied and you think a quick slap will put a stop to it?
It has once in my past. I mean, the exact same thing happened.
Well, see, that is kind of when I describe my own incident, that is kind of the way it was with me. If somebody in a rare moment, once in a blue moon, I mean once in 5, 10, 15 years, is under attack by a woman and slaps her one time in order to stop the beating or whatever, I would have a hard time criticizing the person for that.
Yeah, but I just wanted to put an end to your overall sweeping generalization that one cannot contact a woman under any circumstance.
Oh, I get it. You're busting me because you think I'm a little too general at times?
Yes.
Well, I want to know. I want you to know something, Jim. That really ticks me off, and that's that. Coming up on the news, 2 o'clock, everybody. The Rick Miller Show rolls into the third and final hour in just a moment.
Seattle's talk radio station, King News Talk 1090, KING, Seattle.
Here's the latest from ABC News. I'm Linda Moore. Score one for the defense in the O.J. Simpson case. Los Angeles Superior Court Judge Cecil Mills has dismissed all 23 members of the grand jury considering an indictment.
In the interests of fairness and justice to all involved, the court has ordered recusal of the 1993-94 grand jury from further consideration of this matter.
The move follows a motion filed by Simpson's attorney today to poll members of the grand jury to determine if they've been influenced by pretrial publicity. More from ABC's Jane Platt in Los Angeles.
Both the defense and prosecution had expressed concerns about pretrial publicity, in particular about the release these past few days of 911 tapes, emergency calls made by Nicole Simpson to police. So Superior Court presiding Judge Cecil Mills has disbanded the grand jury for now. It does appear very likely now the preliminary hearing will go forward as scheduled next Thursday. Now, although the grand jury proceedings are private, the preliminary hearing is conducted in open court, and that's where prosecutors must try to prove that there is enough evidence to go forward with a trial. Linda?
ABC's Jane Platt in L.A. Now this.
Hi, my name is Kayleen. I'm 5 years old. Last summer...
206 of King 1090. Welcome to the third and final hour of the Rick Miller Show. Two down the drain. You might as well shoot the third one and call it a complete loss, a complete washout. Everything's coming up dandelions right now.
As they say in rocker, soccer, Rick, a hat trick.
A hat trick. That's right, Sean. Sean's playing Wayne in with a speaking part on the Rick Miller Show. Sports Illustrated, the latest Sports Illustrated, their cover story is O.J. Simpson as well. And I have read, of course, the Time Magazine account, the Newsweek account, and the Sports Illustrated account. And I would recommend the Sports Illustrated account to anyone who wants to have a... You will read things in the Sports Illustrated account and kind of see a quality of writing and supposition that you do not see in either Time or Newsweek. In reading Time and Newsweek, I did not learn anything new at all. Everything I read in both, I already knew. Except in Newsweek, there was one little thing, one nice little detail. I should have underlined it. It's such a small matter. It was something almost as small as the distance at Nicole Simpson's house from the front gate to the door or something, 15 feet or whatever. And I thought, oh, well, that helps me to visualize things a little more. It's something that small. But Sports Illustrated has some real interesting subjective writing, I guess you would say, exposition, I don't know exactly how you describe it. But during the rest of the show, I'm going to read you a little snippets of insight from the Sports Illustrated article. So you will see the way a publication that most of you probably are not familiar with is handling this story. It's some incredible writing, and I will bring you several portions of the article in this hour. I think, and I'm going to do that for one reason, it's great writing. There are some insights involved that we haven't read elsewhere, and I just think it's interesting. For an example, this is the, oh, gee whiz, I don't have the author's, I don't have the page that has the byline. Sorry about that. Anyway, quoting, I'm taking these pieces, I guess you would say out of context, but I think they can all stand alone. Always the subject is the O.J. Simpson case and all that is involved. For an example, how about this? The cruelty of the murders, the fury it must have taken to perform them, was otherworldly. If O.J. Simpson was that killer, a lot of what we think we know about human behavior must be reconsidered. Simpson was so self-effacing and eager to please that he was deemed unthreatening to whites, and thus became the first black athlete ever to be embraced as an endorser of products not marketed solely to blacks. I know he beat her, says a prominent agent who is in the same social loop as O.J. Simpson. It was common knowledge. A lot of his friends knew it. Not just the 1989 incident, but all the beatings. They all tried to keep it quiet, just like Magic Johnson's womanizing. In the small circle these athletes socialized in, people just didn't ever go public with this information. They protected him. And I'll bring you other little excerpts in the Sports Illustrated article throughout the rest of the show. By the way, obviously, any other comments you have about the recusal in the O.J. Simpson case, which I so splendidly explained a little while ago, if you have a thought on any of that, of course, that's most welcome as well. By the way, the careful listener knows that at the start of the show, I brought up two other subjects, expressed my interest in them, and, of course, they were totally ignored. Stephanie and Kent, you're on King 1090.
Hi, Rick.
Yes, Stephanie.
You were talking about 1 o'clock, about accommodation, domestic violence being a learned behavior. My mom comes from not just an abusive household, but her father would actually torture the mother. She died indirectly because of that. Mm. My mom, you can only imagine, being the oldest, had to keep the kids out of the way, accommodate the dad, don't provoke him in any way. When my brother was born, he was the firstborn, it's my entire life it has been, don't provoke your brother, don't make your brother angry.
Oh, brother.
Oh, brother.
Isn't that something?
Everything, I was the scapegoat. I was a good kid, I might add, and I'm not just making myself look good. Don't make your brother angry. Mm-hmm. My brother is in his 30s now, and I'm 30. It's still... don't make your brother mad. My brother was never abused. I was never abused. But because my brother was set up for it, he became abusive toward me. Because if I did the slightest thing, he'd go off.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
And did he do that? Did he beat you up?
Oh, didn't just beat me up. He'd pick me up, throw me into the chimney, bang my head on the coffee table.
At what age?
Oh, God, probably 7 to 17.
And did your parents know about this?
Well, my dad was not around after the war. But my mom is in such a state of denial, and I might add, you can say, Mom, you have a high rate of denial. No, I don't. That's where I'm coming from.
She denies any of this happened?
Any. My brother laughs about it.
Your brother acknowledges it?
He laughs about it. He gets a kick out of it.
Are you friendly with him?
I see him 5 minutes a year, and I almost throw up. I get so sick.
Oh, my. And your mother knows that?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, what does your mother think is the reason why you see your brother 5 minutes per year and even get sick at that?
Because that's how my dad and his brother were, so it's genetic.
Oh, Lord. Oh, my God.
And my mom is a nice person.
Yeah.
I'm not saying she's a witch.
Yeah.
But the list you read earlier about men abusing their wives, if you fit this list,
yeah,
my mom fits that list to my stepdad, all but number 3.
Okay, let's go down the list. This is going to be instructive. You're saying, as I read this list, we're talking about whether your mother fits the
list.
My
mom is.
Okay, here it is. Here it is. Is she controlling?
Yeah.
Does she expect you to conform to her time schedule and list of priorities?
Yes.
Does she have you call in and report to her, or does she have this man?
My stepdad?
Yeah.
He's a total doormat.
She's a doormat. Does she get mad if he's not on time?
Oh, yeah.
Does her anger take over in which she pushes, shoves, slaps, or hits?
Yeah, and she's broke all the dining room chairs, too.
And she smacks him?
She doesn't smack him. She's more verbal.
Mm-hmm. So she's verbally abusive.
She'll ruin furniture. She'll throw it at the door after he leaves.
Okay, why do you suppose... So your mother is the domestic assailant.
Yes. Not when we were kids, though, just to my stepdad now.
Why do you suppose she is? Can you figure that one out? I can't.
It's scary. I think...
Learned it from the ex-husband, or...?
No. My dad was a pretty good guy, but he was a womanizer. He never abused her physically. I'm sure by being a womanizer, that had an effect on her.
Uh-huh.
Emotionally. But I think she never abused his kids, but then suddenly when she had a man, she wanted to be the controller instead of letting a man get one up on her. She wanted to be up on the man.
Well, maybe she had so swallowed her anger and her pride that she it was bursting to get out. And when she saw the opportunity, or she created an opportunity to get even with men in general.